Hello everyone and welcome to round number 6, our final round from our August 2v2 tournament. This time we are featuring PB Head Gameslayer, Death Tacticus, and Blues. Now, Death Tacticus and Blues have already secured their victory in this tournament. However, Gameslayer and PB Head are fighting for second place. If they can take the win over the so far undefeated Death Tacticus and Blues, PB Head and Gameslayer have secured themselves second place. However, if they lose, they may end up in a tiebreaker situation, and that would be very unfortunate for them, as one of their wins in particular was a very, very long game, and the tiebreakers are based on the time it took for you to achieve your victory. So, quite a lot on the line still in this one. PB and Gameslayer really going to be looking for this win, and you can see they're even kind of making an effort, it looks like, to make this game a fast one. We see double robot out of PB and Gameslayer. A lot of on-world prices starting pretty low. That might not be what they're looking for. But chemicals and electronics both available. You can see Blues and DT maybe identifying the especially valuable chemicals this game. They go for the scavenger play. This allows them to very, very quickly get into chemical production and start pulling in money off of it. You can see Blues already with a triple refinery down this game. I like it in response to all of these chems at the neutral. And then, of course, the laboratories there as well. You're going to knock that price down fast, but that's okay. It looks like Gameslayer has also moved into triple chem refinery, though. So the interesting situation here is that because Gameslayer and PB do not have a lot of carbon production, they're not really benefiting from this high carbon price. Maybe makes upgrading a little bit harder for DT and Blues, but long term that high carbon price is likely to work in their favor. They should be able to overwhelm carbon and start knocking that price down, start actually gaining a profit from carbon rather than committing all of it to upgrading. And so Gameslayer and PB, they're going to have to be a little careful about where they let that price get to. Now, Gameslayer is producing enough carbon to cover his chems while they're online, but that still means that price is ending up pretty high and they're gaining no benefit from it themselves. Looks like Blues and DT have gotten very aggressive with the black market very quickly. Meanwhile, Gameslayer and PB really haven't done a whole lot with it just yet. Instead, we've just got DT and Blues really focusing on a lot of black market, a lot of defense going on here toward Blues power production. We have a solar flare coming in. So if Gameslayer had managed to get some solar panels down, that could be very, very nice to counteract these wind turbines out of Blues, but that's just not the case. No solar panels down just yet. And unfortunately, our robotic players kind of fallen behind on upgrades to our scavengers. Things are not looking good quickly this game for PB and Gameslayer. Well, what are we going to have here? We do start to see some full solar panels coming down. Unfortunately, kind of a bit late. Not going to get huge benefits off this solar flare. They will get some, but of course nighttime is also on the way, so things just aren't looking too pleasant. On top of that, PB and Gameslayer, because of how they founded and so on and so forth from there, they haven't set themselves up in a position to actually pull in any money off of power, whereas Blues, he's only got 14,000 debt. These turbines will all be online very, very soon, and so he should be able to start paying through that pretty easily once all these turbines are online and start actually pulling in some money from that valuable, valuable power. On top of all that, not just not making money from power, but Gameslayer with that 20,000 auction pushed himself down to a C rating just for a claim. This means that when nighttime comes and that interest ticks over, he is going to be at risk of falling into D very, very quickly, putting them in an even worse position. And the mutinies come through against PB, it looks like. Gameslayer managed to take a solar panel back, it would appear. But unfortunately, it's just not very much. You can see that Blues has managed to pay through all of his debt. Is covering DT's power costs, of course, making sure DT doesn't gain too much debt himself. and has managed to make a small amount of money on that power production. Meanwhile, PB and Gameslayer just tons and tons of debt. We definitely want to see this interest tick come in for Gameslayer. See where he lands. Yep. $20,000 of interest, putting him solidly into a D level of debt already. That was the second interest tick of the game, and Gameslayer already that far into debt. No wonder DT and Blues let that claim go for a mere $20,000. Both scavengers hitting four before either robotic player gets there. And we do see a patent lab having come online for Blues. He is immediately moving into superconductor once again, expecting power to stay valuable. I like this play, especially as a scavenger. Once again, the black market tools are actually not very good for our scavenger players this game. They really only have two ways to be aggressive against these solar panels. However, they can use them for the time being and use them quite well. Continue to put Gameslayer and PB into more and more debt. Continue to make money on this power. Commit that money, maybe, mostly into this black market. But it leaves you in a position where you have no debt, your opponent has a lot of debt, and you can very easily start to get aggressive against them. And in fact, Blues and PB, or Blues and Death Tacticus, feel so confident right now. Rather than taking out the relatively weak Gameslayer, who costs only probably about, when all is said and done, maybe 65, 70,000 to finish off, Blues is going to get aggressive immediately against the more powerful PB. He wants to take those solar panels away. He wants to knock out the only player who could actually pose any kind of threat whatsoever, and then save Gameslayer for an easy pickup as he continues to gain more and more debt.
Congratulations. Well,
I guess when you're already in D levels of debt and committed to dying, teleportation for 20,000 really isn't going to hurt you all that much. So sure, why not? Gameslayer going to be moving well below that $10 stock price. Bit of an interesting decision out of him, but definitely a Gameslayer style of move. Ah, things are already going horribly. How much worse can they get? Blues still pulling in cash off power. You can see power finally, power has managed to come online well enough that the price is dropping, but it feels like it's just going to be too little, too late. Gameslayer's got enough cash, he can buy one little unit of stock, but together, Blues and DT have the cash for the kill. So they could pretty easily just start dumping all their money into electronics, put all that money over to Blues. And Blues just finishes off PB. This means Gameslayer should be rather easy to take down from here. He's already got $161,000 of debt. Yes, he can upgrade a couple of times, bring his stock price back up, but still not very high at all. And that interest tick is on the way. What is we going to drop to here? $48,000 of debt added with that interest tick. $200,000 total. Gameslayer still holding on to his stock price okay, of course, because, well, he managed to get those upgrades done. This drastically increased his asset level by picking up those upgrades, and so his stock price is staying okay, but he still never managed to get out of that D level of debt despite increasing his assets so drastically. Never has had access to the black market since falling into that D level. No opportunities to get aggressive against Blues and DT. So I still would expect that even at HQ5, Gameslayer, there's not going to be a whole lot for him to do. He is trying to hold on as long as he can. Although I don't know if that truly matters at this point, extending the length of this game. Blues and DT, they may still be able to just go ahead and finish up right here and now on the back of this glass and electronics production. And there you go. Soul 4, hour 10 win. Over to Blues and DT. Just well done. Good use of scavenger. Kept hammering with that black market. I'm actually going to take a look at that this time. And you can see, let's see, it might be easier to look at in the overview here. Yeah, PB hits DT once. Gameslayer hits Blues twice, DT once. So four attacks total. And I think most of those were against mutinies anyway. Well, two of them were mutinies, two of them EMPs, whereas We had, let's see. It says the DT actually got aggressive against blues at some point. I assume that's an EMP. But still, 5 uses of the black market from DT and 2 out of blues. So 7 uses compared to 4. You can tell that kind of being a scavenger really helping out there. I think this starting debt for PB and Gameslayer was just very, very painful. Both of them having such a huge amount of debt, and then Blue is able to get on the board with none. And you can see this is most of the game right here, right? Blue's 126,000 sold power. Whereas Gameslayer, he just bought a lot of power. PB bought more power than he sold. DT didn't really do a whole lot with power, but that's to be expected since Blue's was covering things for them. So, it's nice. Good solid win over Blues and DT. That means we have to check the tiebreakers. And let's see. Once again, twitch.tv/yearend. I'm going to go ahead and link it in chat once more for that final game, which is still going at this moment. Dermis bringing up a good point there, that electronics price starts expensive and glass starts halved. Makes things a lot easier for our scavengers to expand and a lot harder for our robots to. So that's definitely something to have considered when founding that game. That it looks like Gameslayer and PB were not able to identify quickly enough. It's worth pointing out, by the way, that it's very, very difficult to found in a 2v2 situation because you are trying to both examine the map and coordinate with your partner at the same time to, like, identify, all right, here's some good spots I'm finding. And not only here's some good spots, but here are some good spots that'll support both of us. You'll notice when we had a scavenger, every single time we had a scavenger this tournament, we had 2 scavengers. And that's actually holding true for the other round 6 match that we're seeing right now, where there are 2 scavengers, and then it's always either double scavenger or 2 steel users, because you kind of want to make sure that you're both using that same basic resource. It makes life a lot easier. So you've got to, if you're even going scavenger, you have to make sure, all right, we're both going scavenger, and that really needs to be communicated. And if you don't want to go scavenger, that also needs to be said, so both of you can think about what steel using colony you want to be using and what to be looking out for there. So, very, very complicated getting the found correct in 2v2. You have to really be able to communicate well and make sure that you both understand what's going on. Now, looking over at this match on year-end stream, it does look like Dubin and Steph are doing quite well for themselves. Managed to eliminate one of their opponents in a majority buyout. Both of them are HQ5. Their last remaining opponent has secured 5 stock, but is in a D level of debt and only HQ3. And so that's going to be good news for PB and Gameslayer, as if Polina and Noxie had managed to take this last round, that would have brought them up to 3 points tied with PB and Gameslayer. But as it looks like Polina and Noxie are not going to manage to take this last round, we're going to watch and make sure, but things are looking like they're just going from bad to worse as time goes on. It does look like they're going to end with 2 points, which would give Gameslayer and PB Head the second place finish. It's good to make sure that that's what's going to happen, though. Looks like not a lot of super expensive on-world prices. Aluminum is actually pretty well up there at $80 right now, something to be watching out for. And I think that Steph and Dubin actually have the cash to go ahead and finish the game whenever they want to. They've just got shortages rolling on Kims. They're kind of letting that sit. But of course, they only need 200,000 to get the shift buy onto Polina at this point, to buy all of Polina's stock at once. And they certainly have that much stored away in chemicals. So this game should end. Polina can buy more of her own stock, but it shouldn't make any difference because Dubin and Steph are able to secure the shift purchase now, which already pays double for the price of the stock. And there you can see Dubin goes ahead, sells down the Kims, and takes it Soul 5 victory over Polina and Polished Noxie. So that does secure it. First of all, it's nice. Congratulations to Dubin and Steph for managing to pull it together and pick up a win during the tournament. Always good to see. So all of our teams managed to grab at least one win today. But of course, congratulations most to Blues and Death Tacticus. They are going to finish things up with 6 points. Game Slayer and PB, they take second place with 3. Polina, Polished Noxie, going to end with 2. And then finally, Dubin and Steph do manage to pick up a win in round number 6 and end this tournament with 1 point. So, well done to all our teams, but big congratulations, of course, to Blues and Death Tacticus for their undefeated victory in our 2v2 tournament.